Well, hello everybody. I hope 2020 is treating you as well as it can. This has been one heck of a year. Borrowed a GoPro from a friend, so I figured now that I have both of my hands free, I can answer some questions that people had had about the differences between incandescent and LED traffic lights. So we will jump right into it. Basically, there really isn't a difference between the two. It's simply what you put inside of it. You can think of a traffic light as a host for a light source. Now, in the case of an incandescent signal, I'll just grab this one here. Really quite simple. You have your reflector, you have a light bulb, and you have your lens. This reflector is hinged. You can see it's got this tensioning here to hold this socket in place. And then behind that, you have the terminal block. That's where your wires, this is going out to the controller, and these are going out to the sockets of the individual indications. Your standard traffic signal bulbs are in kind of an odd wattage. They look pretty much identical to what you might find in the house prior to the old LED conversion. I'm sure there's some of you out there who are still running CFLs and incandescents. But basically what happens is this lamp comes on and it fills this reflector with light that is then passed through the lens, and you get the colored indication. There are two different types of lens. You have polycarbonate, I'll try to get you good, and then you have a glass. There are benefits and drawbacks to both. Glass lenses will obviously last longer. They will maintain their color. They will not burn. But the downsides are is that they are slightly more fragile. Somebody shooting at it with a gun, for example, or throwing rocks, or even if the signal were to fall, would cause the lens to break. Polycarbonate lenses won't shatter the way a glass lens will. However, they do have their own drawbacks. For starters, they are susceptible to heat, and obviously this bulb puts out a lot of heat, and when this is closed, that bulb is right up against the inside of this lens. And what you used to see, you don't see it much anymore, is signals that would be on green or red for a very long time. You'd get a big burn mark in the middle, and if the agency in charge of maintaining that signal was not very proactive, you would get it would actually go through the lens. You'd be able to see the bulb. I recall seeing that in several places around here before the LED conversions almost 20 years ago. Hard to believe it's been that long. And what's amazing is about 80 to 85% of those LEDs are still working, though they are really starting to drop off as time goes on. Real quick, this is a Singer section. These are Krauss-Heinz type R sections. Singer was the only company, apart from TSI, Traffic Signals Incorporated, to use these Zeus, spelled D-Z-U-S, fasteners. And they're originally designed for use on maintenance panel on aircraft. It was an easy way to open and close and make sure it was secure. And this pin, you can see it kind of grabs onto this rod here, and then as you turn it, it pulls the door shut. And it has a very satisfying noise. And you see, if it doesn't grab right away, you keep turning it, there it starts to pull, and it's secure. Not quite as weather tight as the traditional wing nut, which is why they didn't really catch on, but certainly a unique piece of traffic signal history. Now, the lenses I showed you here are polycarbonate and glass. The reflectors behind them were aluminum, a material called Alzac, A-L-Z-A-K. I'll pop this open real quick to give you an idea. You can see it's kind of just a simple aluminum, really nothing to it. Older signals used glass reflectors, and I think I will show you this one, even though I'm not able to open it too far because of the visor knocks into this. But this is probably one of the best conditioned glass reflectors I have. This one was found by a friend on eBay, and as you can see, it's in excellent condition. The reflector that was in this section to begin with, because the signal rested on weight for most of its life, the heat from the bulb had actually scorched the silvering off. most of the reflector and had rendered it pretty much worn out, used up. So the benefits to a glass reflector like the ones you'll find in here, and then this is from the 1950s, this is from the late 30s, early 40s. Obviously you get a superior mirror grade finish, but again, going back to the glass lenses, it's far more susceptible to shattering from impacts, vandalism, things of the like. And then again, you get that silvering in the glass from the heat of the bulb, especially if the bulb remains on for an extended period of time, can tend to scorch off that silvering. And you can see sort of in here, there's some spotting going on, but that's simply age related. It doesn't really affect the way these reflectors work. And all of the reflectors in this signal are original. The glass in this one is actually all original, and it is in absolutely fantastic shape. I'm over the moon with the shape that signal was in when I got it. I didn't have to replace really any parts. Minus the paint, it is all original. So we'll do a quick stop off at the 3M just to kind of give you a comparison before we move on to the LEDs. The 3M does not use reflectors. It simply uses a Fresnel lens that magnifies the light from a halogen bulb that is placed at the rear. And one of the selling points that 3M used was that the heat of the lamp is isolated from the lens and it won't burn it. So that is where the lamp on a 3M is. And you can see this connector here mates up to a socket here, and when you pull that door open, the power is severed, so you don't blind yourself. Can I get it one more turn? Yep. And then just for comparison, so you can see what's in here, so you don't have to pause this and go watch the other video, I invite you to do so. I'll leave a link in the description below. This is really what's inside a 3M signal. Get all dirty. Your Fresnel lens, and then this piece here is a clear piece of glass. The frosted part is the diffuser that is behind it, but that's really all that's in here. And this lens does all of the light magnification. It's a pretty unique, pretty clever system. But since we're here, give you guys a little bonus. This is my neon indicator controls 16-inch pedestrian signal. I'll try to hold this back so you can kind of get an idea for it. Now, this is one of the later versions. This neon unit is completely modular. There's no transformers or anything of the sort. You can see it just plugs in. And this is it right here. Actually, I think we'll set it here. And then we'll lift it back up. Prior to LED, I know there's a few people out there who think that neon is superior to LED, and that's something we could debate. But when it comes to cold weather performance, neon is really not a happy camper. Especially with this fluorescent, the man is actually fluorescent tubing, or fluorescent style tubing. I'm not entirely sure exactly what it is, but it's not true neon. The hand is a true traditional orange neon. This TCT has the Alzac reflectors, cop glass lenses, pretty standard stuff. It was made in 1997, pretty typical for end of the road for the all incandescent signal as a default. Next, we're going to take a look at our Seattle McCain here. This signal I got, it had the GE GT1 LED modules in it, and I replaced those with these clear lens Leotech IL6. This is the most recent P3 iteration, and the first thing you notice when you open a signal that's been converted to LED is there's really not much going on in here anymore. The reflector's been removed. You can see the pin here. And there's another smaller pin down here, as well as these brackets here, 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 and here. And that would have, these pins are what the reflector would have swung on. And these little dowels, or not, I think dowels, these little castings, kept the reflector from getting pushed back. It basically ensured that the reflector met up with the lens correctly. But once the signal is converted to LED, the lens is removed from here, the reflectors are removed from here, and the LED module simply takes its place inside the door. Now, we're gonna make a jump over here to this indicator controls 16-inch incandescent pedestrian signal. The reason I wanted to show you guys this one is it's actually got some really clever engineering that you can't see from the outside. So we're gonna go ahead and open this one up, if I can do this. Vehicle signals is a lot easier to kind of, you can kind of hit these and they'll spin, but the pedestrian signals don't like it as much. Now the way this works is, this reflector, you see the gasket kind of gotten pinched there, simply sits in here. It's not secured or screwed down in any way. These bulbs, if you need to access the wiring behind here, you simply remove the bulbs and this just slides right out. Now the clever engineering part, you can see here, and then there's another one, it may be hard to see from your angle, is here. Now what that does is, imagine if you had these bulbs pressed right up against this lens, you would have all that heat trapped in here and you would find this getting warped, you would find accelerated heat damage from your to your lenses. That heat has to go somewhere. What these holes do is they allow that heat to escape this area, go into the housing itself, where the housing acts as a metal radiator and allows that heat to escape into the atmosphere. Pretty clever stuff. Oh no. Oh, now you get to watch me fix something. This, spoiler alert, just gets held up by that. I was trying to make sure, I use these hose gaskets to keep these from falling down, because if you just lean them up, they tend to want to slip, especially on this particle board. It's pretty slippery. So once we get this like so, we'll just kind of pull this forward, and there it is, and that's still upright. All right, it is warm in here. As you can see, it's about 86-87 degrees in here. This is another indicator controls corp pedestrian signal. This one, however, was originally designed for neon, but I converted it to LED. There's a long story there. So this is a General Electric GE. This is the VLA series of their pedestrian signal, and this is basically what that module looks like. And it simply rests inside the door where the lens would have rested. The reflector would have been removed had this been an incandescent signal. You can see there are no sockets. There would have been a big metal plate here with holes for the bulb sockets. And then it's simply wired in where the neon module or the incandescent sockets would have been. Now, you may find yourself asking, why is there all this space in here on newer signals when nobody's really making or buying incandescent pedestrian signals anymore? And there's actually quite a good reason for that. When municipalities install accessible pedestrian signals, like the ones that talk and they tell you where you are and the direction you're going, and some of them will even count down how much time is left, that button has to interact with this module in one way or another. So what they tend to do is they mount the hardware for that accessible signal in here. And with those slimmer signals that Econolite made, there was not enough room. So it wound up being the past also worked for the future, and the future didn't work for the present. So that's why they continue to make these as big as they do. It's a practical thing. So I'm gonna set these back down on the gaskets. And we're just gonna, this one tends to spin shut better than the others, and I don't know why. Just kind of do famous last words, that. So that is, in a nutshell, the difference between incandescent and LED vehicle and pedestrian signals. I hope this answered your questions to some extent. But as far as the reasoning for going to LED from incandescent, you have the power savings. a new 12-inch LED from one of the big manufacturers, Dialight, GE, Leotech. Those LED modules, they pared them right down to where they only use about between 6 and 11 or 12 watts of power, which is absolutely astonishing, because a 12-inch signal like this one here uses a 169-watt monster. Actually, you know what? This one's hanging, so I'm going to use this one over here. Monster of a bulb. I'll show you real quick. And this is what it looks like. Make sure I don't drop this. I mean, look at that. Thing is huge. So this is 100 and basically 170 watts, and it's only good for 8,000 hours. Where instead you can buy something that'll last you over 100,000 hours and only uses between 7 and 11 watts of power. Really a no-brainer. 8-inch signals like these tended to use 69-watt bulbs. The 8-inch signals, the LEDs I have in here, the Leotechs, all of these 8-inchers are rated at 6 watts, which is just unbelievable. The new GE's countdown, the VLA series, is rated for, I believe, 8 watts for the hand, 7 watts for the man, and then I think the countdown is 8 watts, which is absolutely just absolutely staggering. So that's it. If you guys have any questions, feel free to leave them in the comments. As always, I'll do my best to answer them for you. And stay happy, stay healthy as you can, and hopefully I'll talk to you before the year is out. Take care. Bye-bye.